presently the marketing track, and you're attending a session about promoting LibreOffice in your language. Welcome, and good morning for being here. So very quickly, I thought about doing an introduction. Many of you know me already. My name is Schulz, Charles, and I'm one of the things these days mostly working on promoting LibreOffice on social media, but also contributing to the general marketing. This session has one specific topic, which is the promotion of LibreOffice in native languages. And I've been, so to speak, working on promoting LibreOffice and earlier openoffice.org in precisely worldwide native language communities. And today I would like perhaps to help and share my experiences about precisely this aspect of promoting and marketing LibreOffice and engaging people in the LibreOffice project when you do not, or when you do not speak English, or when English is not your tongue. So let's start right away. We're first going to discuss a little bit, what is perhaps striking when you are not speaking English or English is not your mother tongue at first, which is that language is not an abstract reality. In fact, language is most of the time a geographical, cultural, maybe even economical context. And while I wouldn't say that it is always the case, basically there is a set of realities that frame where your language and how your language lives, grows, declines, maybe. And this in turn makes for different realities based on the language and the area you are speaking. So here I've got a very, very summary, perhaps even schematic set of examples of types of language matching today's realities. And of course I'm not suggesting that all these actions or all these kind of approaches are what you must absolutely adopt, but basically these are maybe approaches that have been seen sometimes to be more of a priority in comparison to others. So the important thing when you're considering the promotion of LibreOffice in languages other than English is that you need to tailor and at least think about your approach. So, as a set of examples, for instance, we're going to have Indic languages. So if you're visiting into India, what we can see is that what really interests our volunteers on the field is going to be education and raising the brand awareness. That is one example. If you're going to Western Europe, and to a large extent Eastern Europe too, what you're going to have is forms of promotion that involve much more social use of social media and guerrilla marketing, for instance. Then you have Portuguese in Brazil, and which is perhaps not the same that Portuguese in general. Well, you're going to have a reality, the reality which is the reality of Brazil and free and open source software in Brazil. So the approach will be a bit different. There will be that user supports, developing and growing skills, and of course the relations with the national and local governments. Then, Asian, Chinese, Japanese, and Korean. Of course, these three countries and these three cultures and these three languages encompass wide cultural differences. I'm not putting them in the same basket because I don't know better. It's just that they share, so to speak, a common reality, at least from what I can see, and which is about indeed a sophisticated form of social media, that's one thing, but But, and at least that's my experience with China and PRC, distribution. That is how you insert LibreOffice somehow in the distribution. How people are going to get LibreOffice. Because most of the time, for instance, in PRC, you're going to have people who are very happy to use pirated software from Microsoft. And that's just about it. But so if you manage, so to speak, to get distribution deals involving money or not, then you're striking something really big in PRC automatically. African languages, of course, here again, encompassing a wide variety of languages, cultures, spaces, then you're going to have here a different kind of approach, which is going to focus mostly on education, but also distribution. Here again, distribution itself being quite different from the distribution patterns you can have in PRC, for instance. So, this being said, here is, I wouldn't say a standard list, but it's basically a list of actions that is always good to have. There's not one unique recipe, but at least there are things that may not be obvious, but these are just being useful, and that you may want to consider when promoting LibreOffice in your language. So of course, it starts with an online presence, website, and a few years ago, they stopped there, but no, it's not just the website. The website and the home, this is not where you can beam and spread the news about LibreOffice. So you need a website, you need active social media accounts. Active social media accounts means active social media accounts, not, let's say, Twitter accounts sleeping. Otherwise, it's not really good use. But it also means being available and having a strong presence on social media. It may seem obvious, but it is not. I'm very happy, I must say, when I'm looking at Google Plus, for instance, when I look at all these LibreOffice groups that basically exist for a wide number of languages. I'm very happy for that because that shows there is traction. But there are cultures and languages and groups and sociologies that essentially do not encourage the presence in social media. Some people will just be like, hey, I'm not on Twitter. It's okay not to be on Twitter. But there are people who will say, no, I'm not on Twitter, so why should I be on Twitter? Well, the point is not what you do. The point is not what you want to do. The point is that if you actually want to spread the word, you need to use the channels and the networks that are available to you. That also means another thing, which has, let's say, a little bit more of a trolling potential than what I've said on the topic so far. We will meet, and I'm sure there are people here or in other groups who will tell you, it's very important to privilege social networks that do not do, let's say, data mining on your profile and what have you. It's very important not to be on Facebook because Facebook is evil. I think Facebook is evil. Many people think that Facebook is evil. This being said, Facebook is where everybody is. So I do not care whether you feel that Facebook is evil. I do not care whether you think that diaspora is the best thing since sliced bread. I think diaspora is an excellent, beautiful idea. But Facebook is where everybody is. And if you're not on Facebook, then you're Google Plus. Very good, let's be on Google Plus because there's a whole lot of people who are on Google Plus too. So it's fine. But again, you need to be where your existing and potential users are. So, swallow it up. Then, docs and interactive presentation of LibreOffice. I must plead guilty because I'm probably the bad example here. But essentially, if you can have anything from, you know, standard brochures, they don't have to be 6 pages long, it's not about that. Just small presentation brochures, like maybe one leaflet, maybe one, you know, one sheet of paper, at least something you can print, or just simply share by email. It's just fine. That gives you a very simple kind of collateral that you can work with. And of course, interactive video presentation. We started to see, thanks to the recording team, some very nice presentation videos about LibreOffice this year. I hope they will be translated more, first of all in English, and then they can be spread in for other worldwide teams. Then, of course, meetings and event participation. I think this one is quite obvious. We usually do not have much of a problem explaining this one. Then, this is a bit more complicated, both because it's more difficult, and second, because it's just not so obvious to understand. Growing your user base and attracting new contributors. We've said this before, but marketing recipes for LibreOffice as a community tend to be kind of no-go. Because if you try to apply traditional marketing techniques, doing SWOT teams, you know, pricing mix or what have you, it's not going to work. The product is both catering to such a broad range of users, and the product itself is not a product. It is a community producing the software. So it's a bit complicated at first, but one of the logical consequences of that is that, in fact, when you are promoting LibreOffice, you're not just promoting the fact that LibreOffice is a great software suite. You're actually promoting the fact that there is a community and that anyone can join. And in fact, any user, anyone who made the conscious decision, or maybe the unconscious, if wrong, to download LibreOffice, use it, at that very moment, he or she is a potential candidate to join your community. And I know that it's very hard for our contributors who are localizing LibreOffice to even have time to set up, you know, some sort of you know, welcoming community with a user support activity on one side, maybe localized quality assurance for localized builds on the other, localization team next to it, maybe a little bit of translating documentation activities. That is actually quite hard because it simply requires time and it simply requires manpower, which most of us do not have. Then, and you've noticed that I put this as the last one, although this is far from being an exhaustive list, of course, I've listed the traditional promotions such as ads. I think that might work. We have one good example of how it can work and one bad example. The good example is, well, what Firefox did, Mozilla did a few years ago with their ads in the New York Times. So they had an ad in the New York Times, and their download really showed progress. I mean, big progress. We have another one, which is that it was the ad in the site journal for LibreOffice. And while the downloads do not seem to have decreased, obviously, they do not seem to have increased by any sensible factor after this ad, which to me is very impressive, but you know, these are the facts.
Grow target audience.
I don't know. At least what we saw was an interest in essentially to do with About Us pages and DocumentFoundation.org. Download pages, not really matter, which is a bit crazy.
Well, the German Die Zeit journal.
Yeah, the Die Zeit, yeah. I know. Unglaublich.
The Zeit journal is known for very intellectual, political oriented.
So
technical stuff.
I do not have not seen.
But they are open.
Yeah, but I have not seen. I would say the ad myself.
Yeah.
But it was in paper. That was in paper. That was the funny thing. It was in the paper edition, not inside.
Okay.
So then somebody said, no, it's just as stupid as that. You had no conversion rate because, of course, you could not click. So people suddenly said, okay. And forgot about it. Which is very depressing news for the ad market in paper. But anyway, I'm going to come back to this topic of the growing the community. Because, again, while it may seem very different from marketing, in fact, marketing open source, free open source software, is precisely about growing your community. So the community, as we say, is made of your users and the contributors of any kind that you have. Whether they're developers, localizers, documentation writers, people providing user support, people providing, working on the quality assurance of localized builds, showing up at events to help you with the booth. This is your community. And you need to grow that. You need to grow at least some part of it, because in fact, that is how you grow your market share. And that is how you grow your user base. Do not think, please, do not think that you're in some sort of company or there is the team on the one hand, and then there is your customers, aka your market. No, that's not gonna work. First of all, because you have no money, let's face it. And you're not an entity doing business. Therefore, you do not have this money-based relationship that you're gonna have with customers. So you're going to have users, and these users are going to be sometimes noisy, and sometimes they're going to thank you, and sometimes a small chunk of them might actually even be interested in helping. And helping, of course, they can do in various capacities. Even if they're not technical, that's okay. You also meet these people. Again, attending booths. Ensuring that people asking questions online are being answered, helping them with documentation, producing maybe collaterals. Maybe you need something like a big poster for whatever event. So all these people can help. And of course, you have the localizers and people who are able to invest more time in providing quality assurance and contributing to the quality assurance. So it's very important to nurture your local community, the community in your language. Now, it sounds a little bit different, but it's actually pretty much the same continuation. When you have a community, and the bigger your community is, the more it shows inside the wider LibreOffice community. In fact, it's just as simple as that. I call this inbound marketing. The term, I don't think it comes from me, but basically you have inbound marketing and outbound marketing. Outbound marketing is what people usually think marketing is. But in fact, marketing, and I do not have a graph, but I can show you a graph. Marketing starts with tradition, product definition, and usually we call this industrial marketing. And whether you're an industrial player or not, I don't care, we call this industrial marketing. It starts when, out of your corporate strategy, you can derive based not just on market research, but actually based on your resources, your state-of-the-art technology, how you can service your customers, you know, all this. And you have a phase where you have inbound marketing, and this inbound marketing goes from that very moment to the moment you have shipped your product out of the door, and then, you know, everybody's supposed to know about how great your product is. That very moment, the inbound marketing stops, and in theory, you have the outbound marketing where it's going to be promotion, 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 and feedback. So, in LibreOffice, just like in free software projects, inbound marketing is actually extraordinarily important. There are reasons for that. Again, we're not in a framework where you can have customers, and those customers pay in exchange for something. Whether they're in a consumer's market or a corporate market, it doesn't make any difference. When you are inside of the LibreOffice community, operating as a contributor, contributing, well, you're not handling customers by any means. But you only work with the community, and this community can grow or this community can diminish. But if your community grows, you will find out inevitably that in fact you are growing your user base, and therefore you're doing the right job in promoting your office. So it's important that not just that you grow your, you know, your user base and grow your community of contributors, it's actually extremely important that you ensure that your community is integrated, really integrated, inside of your office project. Is it easy? Well, processes, structures, even when they're not overly written or detailed or not even heavy, are one thing. They can help by being effective and by proving that they're effective. This is one thing. But I don't think, in my experience, this is the difficulty. The real difficulty is cultural differences and language barriers. You first have to deal with the fact that every individual is unique, and you're going to have shy people. Shy people who may not want or dare to express themselves on a public mailing list, even in their language. But after that, if you send them and say, like, you need to tell, I don't know who, in English, because he is maybe German or she is Italian, and you need to tell them about something, then you will have, you will see people who are going to be just very embarrassed about communicating in an language which is different than their mother tongue. And, you know, the fact is that at the end of the day, many people think that they cannot communicate in English, but actually, in a written form, they can, and they work just fine. So please do not think you need a state diploma in English mastering to speak in English. I can assure you this is not how it works. So the most difficult part is really this side of human interaction. Yet it is the most important, because this is how you show, first of all, that you exist. It shows who you are, it shows what you do, and then it shows you can even have opinions, and your opinions just matter as much as anybody else's. And you're just simply adding to the contributors, so you enrich the broader plot, let's say. So, that would be my main idea for this session. It is really that if you want to think about promoting LibreOffice in your language, it is going to be all about the community. Yes, there are a few obvious things that you can do, which we discussed. Small collaterals, nice websites, being in social media, ensuring that, you know, you can take the right approach and you understand really what would be needed and what's possible, of course, in your own geography, cultural context, aside that, when all is said and done,
growing your community is the most important thing.
Voila, thank you. This presentation was meant to be relatively short because we're here to share. So if you have questions, I mean, I'm sure you do have questions, so please go ahead.
Well, I was just thinking if, for example, in Canada, we don't have any group or association. So, like, as far as the name of our site, if we were going to organize and create one, does it really matter what name we use, or is it just a community interest?
Well, you know, I think it's going to be very. I think it could be very easy. I think we just open a set of pages. On our own website at LibreOffice.org. I don't know what we can do, what is the best approach, or we might have something called ca.libreoffice.org, or maybe you want to have LibreOffice.org/Canada. You know?
CA would be catalog.
Yes.
So we can't use CA.
The code
CA is what?
CA is
catalog. Oh, yeah, UC. The language and the country.
Yes, the language and the country. So we want to avoid. We already discussed that. So we should find another way to expose the countries without political.
Well, we can have what we call regional groups. I mean, you know,
yes.
After all, there's the. I mean, I don't know what really became of the North American group, but instead, I mean, it was transferred into some sort of U.S. group. So I'm sure you can have like a Canada group or something.
We should discuss that with infrastructure.
In Italy, work very well the Libre Italia concept.
You can have Libre Canada.
Yeah, because that recalls LibreOffice. It's the only real product with Libre. So if you go Libre Italia, there is an immediate association, and it does work very well.
So we need to check if we can buy the domain names and so on, the infrastructure and for not only Canada but for Italia
We already have Libre Italia. It's going to be a property of the association soon.
You're well organized and you're big.
No, of course.
We should think also to
just know that in terms of resources,
I think that
the way structure teams we can roll it up.
But the way that's created is also a conversation.
Yeah.
So if you have an existing organization.
This is a brilliant segue, by the way. See the marketing guy, brilliant segue.
But then that becomes a question about is Libre Italia IT, that's Libre Italia, which is a friend of LibreOffice, but it's not like maybe just controlled by GDF. Versus, you know, if you start inside GDF and then Libre Canada wants to do its own thing, then that's a conversation between them. It's just slightly different.
Although I think that we start the Libre Italia on Google Plus. What I've done first was to invite all the people that I knew and all the people that were commenting about open source in the other community. So I was looking at the Ubuntu.it community, always on Google Plus, at the Fedora community on Google Plus, at the general Linux community on Google Plus, and I was just connecting people and sending every now and then a message, that's Libre Italia, do you want to visit it? Because of the peculiar situation of Italy, Libre Italia is, you have to be admitted in Google Plus, so it's not free. It's moderated, and it's going to be moderated forever, because I don't want some people there. It's very clear. You know, in Italy is the only place where there is an association supporting Apache OpenOffice and clearly hostile to LibreOffice. But I mean, really hostile means you are a son of a bitch, which is myself. So this is hostile. So I understand it's a peculiar situation. We are Italians. You should live in Italy for a couple of years to understand how we are done with our mindset works. But this is our
I accept your invitation.
But the fact that we created something that was close, where people was invited to share experiences, worked extremely well. You think that in just over 1 year we have 2,400 people that asked to be associated and are now associated with LibreItalia. In 5 days we have 110 members of the association, which is just crazy. If you think that TDF in 4 years has 200 members, we have 110 in 5 days. I think it's just incredible, and I think it is because we have been able to create a lot of kind of group feeling inside the Google Plus community. So repeating or copying or cloning the Italian experience, I think it makes sense.
Project list and tonight there's a club, there's a marketing workshop later on today.
Yes.
Yeah.
And there's also
So,
thank you everyone.